Welcome to Between Film. In this dialogue, we'll be focusing on revealing and understanding a shadow of self. The late psychiatrist and psychoanalyst Carl Jung developed the concept of the shadow as a part of his theory on the human psyche. According to Jung, the shadow is a natural and universal aspect of the human psyche. It's formed from repressed or suppressed emotions, desires, and experiences. These repressed contents of the psyche often originate from childhood experiences, cultural and social influences, and personal experiences like religious trauma. Greetings. Welcome back to the last and final part of this three-part series on the shadow of self. Today, we're going to be talking about and focusing on the process of synchronizing with our shadow, which equates to healing. So today's conversation is going to be a little bit different. We do not have a series of scenes from movies to really guide us. Today is focused and going to be guided by just the theme itself. You know, we're going to be talking about how do we navigate healing when trying to bring our darker half and our lighter half together to create wholeness. So it's going to be a little bit more sporadic. And so this is where we invite the spirit. And we can start off with an example in terms of processing and synchronizing our shadow into our life, into our journey, into who we're becoming. There was a lot of information that had to be revealed. There had to be a lot of truth. There also had to be a lot of vulnerability on my part. We had to be open. We had to be able to be strong and courageous to look in the mirror and agree and to really take notice and raise it to our consciousness that these are things that we need to work on. These are things that we need to maybe focus on. These are things that we need to give attention to. And so when we got to that point, there was a lot of crying. Just so much crying, because there was crying from letting go. There was crying from seeing that we were part of it. And no one, we feel like humanity, right? It's a human thing that we don't want to be part of what's wrong. You know, like in this concept of right and wrong, we never want to be part of that. And so this approach of seeing it that it's not a matter of right and wrong, and it's not about being right all the time, but we are who we are with the wrong and the right, if still using those terms. It's not a biased, one-sided approach. That does not get us to perfection or to greatness or to God's grace, right? It does not get us to wholeness. There's still a portion of us that's misunderstood. And so for me, I think Stephen mentioned this in last piece of the dialogue last week, that we named our shadow Christopher. For us, that's a creating, a labeling, an identifying of something inside of us that is part of us. And so by doing that, we now can identify things and analyze it a little bit better, right? Christopher is inside of us, is us, but Christopher symbolizes a part of us that is just unaware. Unaware, does not have patience, is very short-tempered, irritable, really doesn't like people, you know, is really hurt, has been severely traumatized, So Christopher, when we look in the mirror, may look like us, but Christopher portrays this really hurt child, right? Because most of our trauma happened in childhood, in that process of development. So, you know, for us, Christopher has been a process of relationship. We've found ourselves having these imaginary spiritual dialogues in our mind with Christopher about certain things. And it could be traumatic events, it could be arguments, it could be intellectual disagreements, it could be anything, really. But we found ourselves being a parent to ourselves, you know, and really sitting there and saying, you know, dang, like, I understand you're very defensive. I get that now, you know, like, and in that process, it helps us create like a language to be able to empathize and speak to that part of ourself that's really hurt, you know. And we have to daily remind ourselves that that part of us is extremely hurt. It's equivalent to going into the hospital and trying to, provide therapy for a really severely traumatized person that's frantic. And like, oh my God, help me, please help me. You know, and she's like, calm down, sir, calm down. You know, we're trying to help you. And they're just frantic, like, like, whoa, calm down. You know, and they just won't calm down. That is how we kind of perceive Christopher. And looks like me, but, you know, is a part of me that just is unaware. Unaware that people love you, love me, sorry. Unaware that there's enough to go around, unaware that you don't need to seek affirmation from others, unaware that perfection is just an idea. It is not something that we can truly physically obtain. It is a pursuit. You know, so like these things Christopher lacks. And so when we're communicating and trying to like really engage in a healing process with Christopher, we have to come up with ways to share this information to fill Christopher in. Say, Christopher, it wasn't like that. Christopher, don't think like that. That person loves you. Why would they do that? And they love you. You know, and that's really hard to do. You know, after a while, though, when you practice it more, it becomes easier. You can do it in micro moments. You know, you get into an altercation with someone, someone rubs you wrong, and immediately you're going through milliseconds of just this dialogue of, should we snap and wild out, or should we just let it go? This person's probably having a bad day too. Is it really that serious? You know, so people that are struggling with shorter tempers, they lack the ability, the strength to, in those micro moments, kind of dispute it, you know, with their lesser self, their shadow, you know, that's uninformed, if that makes sense. So yeah, with that said, we just want to now open it up to anybody, based on what we said and how we said it. How do you see yourself engaging with this healing process or a relationship with your shadow?
I think, for me, it has been very challenging, and it's always an ongoing process because I don't believe someone is healed. I believe people are always healing. There is no such thing as being a perfectionist, just not, you know, going through their own kind of challenges. But I say that to say that when you are aware of that, like, you really try to kind of, I guess, like, question that part of yourself. Like, when we do get triggered, being aware now, we question those moments and really, you know, feel the feels Yeah, that makes sense. Whereas in the past, I never used to do that. And it may have felt like it was a shield for myself to kind of dive in to that shadow of myself. Like I thought for me, it was myself protecting me. And I learned that it wasn't. It's just a lot of, you know, things that I kind of compartmentalized throughout my life, like not really looking into things and just like putting it to the side and then waiting for things to just explode to then have a say and then become vulnerable then. But for me, the shadow is my mother, and I call that shadow Luz. And it's so interesting that me and my mother, we share the same sign. And I never knew that when I was growing up, because I never looked into astrology. But then throughout my life, and I guess you can say like each era, whatever relationships I had during those times, like what was it that caused me to kind of become her? And so later on, once I was looking more into my healing journey, which has only been like 2 years. So it goes to show that being 36, I'm making up years of healing that I've never done. So that's why it's a lifelong journey. And looking back and looking at those moments and times where I felt like my ego was just like hurt. You know, I wanted to be seen. I wanted to be accepted. And I'm pretty sure that's exactly how my mother felt many times. And knowing her, she's very secretive. She seems like she has it all together, like nothing is bothering her. But when, you know, she's upset, she comes out. So as, you know, we're talking about this, I kind of look back and think about my own grandma and maybe my mom's relationship with her. And then I compare my mom's relationship with me. And, you know, that all affects motherhood, how I've been as a mother, the feminine energy that I lacked throughout my upbringing and stuff like that, and how that looked like throughout my relationships, where I think the thirst, the yearning of that acceptance of being loved just without any, like no questions, there's no conditions to that. So I was always looking for that maternal relationship through everyone. And when I didn't get that, or I saw that there were certain things that I knew, like something was just not going to be right, then that's when the trust, it becomes severed. And I believe that that's like one of the biggest thing for me. To have broken trust is then to not even have hope or look forward to having a friendship, having loved ones, or just people in general that are trying to get close to you and stuff like that, because you've been hurt so many times. So yeah, so my journey with healing and with my own shadow and stuff like that, it's an ongoing process for me.
Yeah, given that is, you know, just us four, you know, for those of you who already know, you know, for, I don't want to name the individual, but, you know, but for a certain individual, you know, who I've been contending with, I guess, what, going on 2 years now, you know, it was able to honestly really, really just show me a lot of my own shadow, you know, through that process, like what I'm willing to do when, right. So, well, right. So figuring out what triggers that shadow, what activates it. Right. And so not feeling like the warmth of a community or a particular individual, you know, those things begin to set it off, right? Or like lack of reciprocation, things like that, of that nature. Especially when I feel that I've, I guess, gone above and beyond for the person. And what I've noticed is that, like, in my day-to-day, like, yeah, in my day-to-day life, I almost even try to find like a sense of identity through the spaces I find myself in, you know. I've been learning, you know, of course, not to do it like more alone, but you know, I'm definitely able to see the most of myself, both good and bad, as Aaron mentioned. Right, I'm part of like the solution or the problem when I'm with people. Right, it's like. It's both, right? And so one of the things that set me, you know, in this journey to really taking a hard look at myself was just feeling like siphoned off of. But what I've had to look at through the process, you know, of just honestly just, I felt like I was like just living out of my shadow, honestly, for like the past like close to 2 years. Where it was just like a radical switch where whatever I did, you know, go about doing the way I went about perceiving things in my regular, you know, just day-to-day, you know, life, that switched, and whatever I had compartmentalized and suppressed, they swapped places, right? Because I had ignored it for so long, but it was the trauma that put me in that position. And one of the things about me that is that, like, I guess, like, when I feel justified in my pain, and that's very subjective because everybody feels justified in their pain. I don't even really make like rules. I guess you could say I go as low. I can go low. I don't want to quantify it, but I can go low. And I was even talking about it with a friend yesterday who's even helping like to mediate the space. And you know, it was even something that was mentioned. And I'm pretty sure a lot of it even has to do with, you know, my zodiacal sign. It's just like, to me, right? Like with so much fealty and loyalty that you give to a space, I guess, like, yeah, which I've named Marcus as my shadow. We just turn into like this warmongering kind of personality, you know, one that's just like, oh, word, like, you know, I'm gonna get done like that, or, you know, I see the other person doesn't really have any like, you know, rules or consideration. I really just, the warlord. Because naturally, right, in my day-to-day life, I like to view myself as a pacifist. Like, I'd rather not have those kind of conflicts. But in that, I was ignoring, like, a vital voice, you know, which was still, you know, my shadow still had a lot of important things to input that I ignored along the way. And it just, you know, it turned into anger. And a lot of those things were just, like, the boundaries that I set on maybe how I went about helping. Also, depending on the other, or finding a sense of identity in what you have with the other person, it's not something I would agree with now. And that also set me down an inevitable dark path too, because it's just like, unbeknownst to the other person, it's not really fair either. You know, it's like whether they've signed up for it or not, it's still not a fair thing to put on the other person. It's a huge task. Like, that's really just something that you put on God. You know, it shouldn't really be put on another person. But yeah, like, that aspect of me, Marcus, or the warlord, is definitely not against attempting to take, you know, if they feel like something has been, you know, taken from them. And it's honestly still something that, like, I'm working through, you know. I guess with me, it's just like, sometimes I'm still having trouble, like, empathizing with just the audacity of certain people, you know. And it's just, it's really blood boiling, you know, really, really blood boiling. So I would say I'm still there. But what I have been learning is to pay attention to the initial aggression of my shadow. Like, when it's at a smaller stage, not when it's like ready to erupt, but paying attention to the aggressive feeling that's already bubbling up, because that's basically my shadow. Still me, but if we were to like separate it, let's say as a separate entity, it's basically my shadow tapping me on the shoulder and saying, we don't like that. Like, you know, we don't like that. Like, what would we like to say about that so that we don't have to take any more drastic measures? How can we deal with this root and stem right now? And I think, to a degree, in little spaces, I've been making some improvement, like back where I would just go all out to try to help somebody. I've been setting more parameters on how and when I help people, you know, so that I would say that has been some progress. Also, making room to empathize on just the other person's pain too. That's definitely like a neutralizer for me. Like, when I can sit and just sit and think, damn, like, you know, this person must have really been hurt, you know, maybe misunderstandings or not, like, whatever they may have been going through just must have been really excruciating. And so allowing for a sense of, you know, through the empathy of that thought process, that does provide me like a chill button. Like, all right, you know what, like, I could probably put like my weapons down, you know. I'll still be cautious and pensive, but, you know, maybe I don't have to, maybe I could chill on like the bloodlust or the, you know, or this, you know, yo, you owe me, bro, like, type of, you know, mentality. I've really been, yeah, just having to deal with that aspect of the shadow. Those are really like the more potent ones. And I think, as I've been told by even my own mother, I think there are parts of my shadow that are like extremely arrogant, right? Because it's that sense of arrogance that even fuels the fact that, like, yo, why wasn't I reciprocated to? Like, why wasn't I considered in the space? Why wasn't I given warmth when I gave warmth? You know, like, why? You know, and as a logician, I just have a hard time computing that. Like, the why. Like, the why needs to be answered for me. Like, why? Like, I don't, you know, when you know, if speaking to, you know, the other, you know, it's just like, why couldn't you follow code? Like, just code and conducts of ethics, you know? Like, even through strife and tribulations, I'm still, you know, I'm still willing to uphold my word. And that I would argue is something that I carry, I guess, from my mother. And that's immutable. Like, that does stay with me, whether in my shadow or not. That's something I hold on to. If I can't keep my word with certain things, I do feel like a sense of my identity is lost. So I need to be able to keep my word. Because if I don't keep my word, then what's stopping me from not keeping anything else You know, and I think to me, I would just kind of slip into like a sense of unconsciousness if I just don't keep my word. So yeah, I just get really freaking tight when, you know, despite of whatever pain the other or the or you know the opposing force just can't maintain their word. And I was having a dialogue with my partner the other day, and I basically told, I was like, look, I understand that, you know, I'm gonna hurt people and people are gonna hurt me. But like my biggest gripe is when people hop off the train. Like, that wasn't the agreement, bro. Like, you weren't supposed to hop off the train. Like, you're supposed to ride this through to the last stop. And it's like the fact that you got off, you know, whoever that may be, it's something that just like, like something about like my shadow just can't, like they just can't take it. Like, and so I'm, little by little, I'm trying to just, you know, like I said, apply more empathy. But my shadow is just so resilient. They're just like, F that, man. Code. Stick to the code. You know, regardless of how we feel, we're hurt, but, you know, we stick to code. Because, again, like I said, we find a sense of identity in maintaining our word. So... It's just something I've been dealing with. Just like, how do I deal with individuals that get off the train when they, you know, when they once upon a time, maybe, you know, in situations have agreed to like, nah, like, yo, we gonna ride this out with you. You know, like, how do I reconcile like people that get off the train? Because that there's that part of me that I do seek like also the validity and the love and the warmth from said relationships. So like when people get off the train, yeah, there's a feeling of abandonment that comes with that. And that's another thing with me. Like we don't believe in like just abandoning things. So it's a lot of things I'm trying to reconcile. Like I don't, like maybe I should believe in that to a certain extent. Maybe I shouldn't. I'm still figuring certain things out, you know, to keep it above.
I think that for me, when I think about where I'm at with my shadow, something that's come out recently, and as we're taking this class, I'm acknowledging it and putting it together, is feeling a sense of, because my last couple of experience with work and working with males has been me feeling very unprotected. And especially being a Black woman, me feeling very unprotected, me feeling like I'm smart enough to get your ideas across, but I'm not acknowledged enough to say, hey, Vashti helped me do this, and that has been something that has been very triggering for me. And when I think about like my childhood with, you know, my father not necessarily being there, me having to defend myself, me feeling like I always had to prove myself, or, you know, I noticed that plays a role in me being defensive, of me always having to fight my own battles, of me always having to plead my case amongst people that I don't feel like I should have to, because I want to show that my work speaks for itself, or that I'm a very integral individual, you know, not perfect, but I try my best to be integral. You know, being a person that loves and shows love through the passion and the work that I do, I often think that it would be reciprocated back to me. But I realize that that's not necessarily the case. And so I worked through this too. And I remember as I spoke to both Yesenia and Aaron, one thing that has come up of, you know, is what defines success for me? what does this look like for me? Like now adding my own definition of success, of healing, of protection, of love, of, you know, so it gives me, yes, that's what it defines. That's what it means to me. And I'm okay with it being here, you know? This is what a level of protection means for me. This is what a level of defending Vashti means to me. And that's what I'm going to state here, you know, and informing those that I'm close with to sharing in this definition so that now when you deal with me or if we come into some type of situation, you understand this is my definition so that there is a clarified moment of what that looks for me so that this other side doesn't come out where she feels betrayed, where I feel like I can't trust, where it feels like I start to shut down. I become mute. I go into my own place, you know, like, because I fight to be my raw self, right? And if I feel I can't be my raw self, my genuine self with you, then I can't be around you, period. Because I live that out, you know, through my speech, through how I treat you, through how, and being able to speak my mind freely. You know, we talk as if this is something that's common, but it can't be common because not everybody can accept that level of freedom. Not everybody can accept it. Not everybody can understand it. Not everybody can live it. You know, so I fight to be there, but I also understand where it's not welcomed. And when it's not welcomed in at work, I don't want to be there. It's not a good place for me. It's not a safe space for me. When it's not welcome at, you know, church, it's not a safe place for me. When it's not welcome in my groups, it's not a safe place for me, you know, because I fight for this person who feels like a young girl always having to be protected, always having to be covered. And I know it comes from that, you know? I know it comes from there. Because, and I see it, how it plays out in certain areas of my life. And it's like, okay, this is real. You know, this is, you are 36, about to be 37. Like, what does this look like? And how are you okay being in this space, knowing that this is a fact about you, a fact about myself? And it's difficult because of what's the thin line of being independent versus feeling that you need to, you know, it pulls out these things that women fight to become, but knowing that they need the love and the protection and the, you know, and I don't feel any way of not admitting to that, you know, that this is a need, that it's a human survival thing, right? And that's my level of love. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you for sharing, Vashti. Thank you all for sharing. This is the kind of talk most people really don't want to go to, and they don't want to have this talk. They don't want to share these things because it reveals our shadow. It's not until we start to embrace our shadow that our perspective changes. What we're proud of, what we're ashamed of changes, you know? And parallel to public space, last full moon, we gathered and we talked about path makers in community. And, you know, from then to now has really inspired us to set the next gathering, the theme to be about, you know, our shadows. You know, our community needs to feel encouraged, empowered to be able to safely and respectfully share and be heard. You know, it is a journey, and I'm glad nobody came to the conclusion that they finished. That would be revealing, but it's a very challenging journey, you know. And it's interesting because we ourselves look around for mentors, people that to look up to learn from, that do shadow work. And all the great examples are not here anymore. They're long gone. And it's very rare to have living examples of people actively practicing shadow work and talking about it, because it seems that once we step into the public light, that shadow just gets drowned out, right? There's a spotlight on you, you know, and in that theopoetic process of having a spotlight on you, the public looking at you, you being a public figure or a leader, somehow in the people's minds, they think that person's perfect. They don't do anything wrong, you know? And it really is just something that keeps me going, because it reminds me of just the horrendous and horrible things that even happen in religion. And in phase three, we did mention that, you know, trauma, but specifically religious trauma, you know, so that's why we bring that up. It's not out of nowhere, but, you know, there's sexual trauma, there's domestic trauma, there's abusive trauma, there's all kind of trauma. It's not just verbal. You know, when people say religious trauma, they think, oh, words hurt you or something, or beliefs hurt you. And it's like, no, you know, it goes to the extent of physical harm, even death. You know, I think a few years ago, less than a decade ago, in South Korea, they were doing Christian conversions, and they were forcefully converting people to Christianity. They were starving them, you know, they were hitting them, slapping them, depriving, water deprivation, you know, and a young woman died out of these practices, a few other teenagers too. But this particular story was focused on this young woman. I think she was like 21. She was young, and through a forceful conversion, they were forcing her to become Christian, and they killed her in the process. So, you know, you also have cases in every denomination of Christianity, not just the Catholics, but, you know, the child pornography, child abusive sexual, you know, sexual abuse. You have pastors, you know, in leadership roles that, you know, manipulate and use their position to obtain women or whatever their sexual preference is. It could even be young men, you know. It happens a lot in the, you know, color community, you know. So it's just these shadows are being ignored, is my point. And this is what happens when we ignore our shadows from the micro to the macro. You know, right now, it's an interesting time. America doesn't have the money to pay their debt. You know, they've been ignoring a shadow this whole entire time. You know, a space of just unawareness. You know what I mean? Like, a space that they're not vulnerable enough to just accept and become better. They just want to portray that they're strong. And they're, you know, so you see this in people, you see this as a country, you see this in symbols and meanings of religious meanings and symbols, you know, it's everywhere, man. You know, so for me, starting my own shadow journey, pointing the finger stopped. There's no finger to point to. We all partake in the same shit, you know, from our choices. People say, oh, did you vote? Did you not vote? You know, like, by not choosing is still an action. So you really can't, no one's innocent per se, you know? And so with that, there's deep humility for me daily. I have to remind myself, I'm not that great. I'm incredible, but I'm not that great. Like, there needs to be a pullback. There needs to be a reminder to, there's work to be done. Or else we fall victim to our peers that are suffering from narcissism and egotistical traps and illusions of power and greed and pleasure and, you know, even this illusion of obtaining things. You know, like, if we're talking spirituality, what is there to obtain physically? You know, but you got so many people focused on obtaining physical things or feeling hurt when they don't have physical things. That's all playing into our shadows. You know, my shadow, Christopher, is a very poor representation of me. Not broke, poor. Broke is the definition of not having money. Poor is a mindset, poverty. You know, and to be poor is to think, to breathe poorly. You don't have enough sustenance. You don't have enough of anything. You're not taking care of yourself. That's poor. You don't prioritize yourself first in terms of care, love. And you can find these, you know, connections when you look at poor communities. The things they lack is not just money. They lack intelligence, schooling, opportunities, shelter, food, clothing, skills, hope. They just lack, you know what I mean? And so for me, Christopher just encompassed all those lackings. And so we kind of have to go through them and really hear it out, empathize, but then say, but that's not happening. That was just what you felt. That's what you thought, but that's not what's happening. That's a very single perspective, you know? And then we have other perspectives that apply more information. Consider that. So even Christopher has to be, that part of us has to be very strong and courageous in accepting new information. Because even Christopher is the most deepest rebel in me. What do you mean? How do I know you didn't tamper with that? You know, like how do I know? Why should I believe you? You know, I have these deep conversations with myself. It's like the deeper conspiracy theorist is in me, you know, like, doesn't trust anybody. Doesn't even trust ourselves. That's how hurt, you know, like, so when God sends messages, Christopher is challenged. How do I know that came from God? You know, and we have to be in relationship with that part of ourselves constantly. And so, you know, we say this because we're also revealing how challenging it is on a second-to-second basis of life. A shaman in journey is deeply challenged by their shadow. They can't escape it. You know, and we created little projects here and there to kind of express feelings and emotions and thoughts from that part of ourself. And that's helped. It has. But we have to do way more work than that. Like Jasenia said, you know, only been doing it for about 2 years, been alive for 36. The ratio is in the negative, bro. I got to catch up. But at the same time, you know, it's not work. You know, I think Jasenia said that too a little bit. Like, it's not work. It's actually something we have to want to do. It's not just check the block. I sat there for 30 minutes. That, you know, like, it doesn't measure up in that way. Like, you actually have to forgive people. You actually have to listen to yourself. You actually have to practice new habits. You know what I mean? Like, you can't just say it up here. And my younger naive self would, more naive self would have been like, oh yeah, if I think it, I can achieve it. You know, like, yes, but not entirely, you know, not all of existence is not cerebral, right? And we've been blessed because our counterpart, our partner, is a Capricorn. And that earth sign really keeps us grounded to what's happening. You know, the real, the reality, you know, the physical even. You know, my partner will remind me while I'm focused on dreams and imagining and, you know, meditation and, you know, outer body experiences. They're like, hold up, because there's some physical shit going on over here. You need to bring your ass back, you know, and it's like, yeah, you're right, you're right. You know, so now it's like, okay, I gotta balance the two, create a good rhythm for myself where I'm not lost in one, but I'm kind of just pushing between the two, bouncing, you know, and I'm getting things from both spaces. You know, that's how we start to feel like we're becoming more whole. We're becoming more in control of ourselves. You know, we develop discipline practices and then hold to it. That's a great feeling. For me, that's success. I made my meeting. Yes. You know, or I did my task. Yes. You know, like whatever it is for you that you find great joy in, your shadow finds joy in that too, but just isn't really, you know, knowledgeable enough. It's like that kid that doesn't want to try anything. It's like, yo, but this is good. You trust me, just try it. Nah, I don't like anything. But you got to try something, you know. There's a lot of great things out here, you know. You know, opening up their taste palette, so to speak. So, what do you guys think about that?
Yeah, just I think what I gather. Sorry, me and it's off. I think what I gather from what you were saying, because yeah, I know, like as a Pisces, right, you have really an imagination, And sometimes, right, although, you know, I'm not a Pisces, but sometimes the things we imagine are very lofty, you know, like our ideals. And I'm imagining what just in links to the space is like the practicality of I suppose like the real arduous, the real arduousness, like how actually difficult it's going to be to actually accomplish, you know, that reality, you know, bringing it from the immaterial to the material, you know, because in our imaginations, you know, we can continue to just imagine ourselves, you know, in this idealized state, kind of like, and there's a trapping in that, you know, we could fall in love with the novelty of ourselves, or we can tend to, you know, add a sense of novelty that in reality we may not really have, in the manner that we're imagining it. You know, it takes more work. And then, you know, it's in the real waking world that we see, like, damn. You know, shoot, like this takes a lot of patience. And you even have to deal with the fact that sometimes your body is not even fully in, like, you know, the temperament and maybe what your body may find itself sometimes doesn't always match, you know, where your mind and maybe even spirit wants to do sometimes. Like the body's just like, oh, we're tired, or, you know, we're fucking drained. Looking at it holistically, you know, from that perspective. And I would say to those times, you know, solitude is required, you know,
to appreciate the help and see it. It's another thing to receive it. Acknowledge that you're not a one-man band, or that we're not people that don't need help, you know? And I think that's a big deal. Like, I'm human. I make mistakes. I need help in certain areas. I got a lot of shit going on, but this will really help me. You know, especially when you have a helpmate, especially when you have a partner, especially when you have somebody, you know, I'm surrounded around amazing friends, you know, like, okay, like these people really support me in this area, you know, being willing to receive that help and acknowledging the areas that I need help in, you know. I don't think friendship is about we all got it together, but I think friendship is about us figuring this shit out together, us holding up each other during those moments where we're down, during those moments when we need a space, during those moments when we just need an ear, you know. I think that's what friendship is about. Friendship is about, you know, not just me and my woes, but me listening to my friend, and maybe they're going through it, maybe they're having a moment. So as I am being poured in, I'm able to pour out love upon, support, and not just with words, but when I got to come out of pocket too, right? I think we fail to forget that. You know, I will always be there for you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I'm going through something right now. All right, cool. I got you. You know what I'm saying? That to me is what it's about. Because as we are adulting and dealing with adult issues and adult problems, that's a big deal. And I feel like we fail to not acknowledge these areas as friends, as partners, but it's like, okay. And of course, like being careful how we speak to each other, being careful how we entreat one another, you know, especially during those moments where we just want to go off. And also not being, using wisdom. And especially if you understand your level of your temper tantrum, you know, it's always good to have somebody to just bring you down. Like, I can't be at that level because we both can't be here. If we both here, none of us is speaking. Like, we're not hearing each other, you know. And again, using that comes with wisdom. And I feel like as we're getting older, I think it's really important as we begin to mature, we need to be mindful of, okay, this is who I am, and I know I have this issue. Like, stop with the bull crap. Like, we're too old for this. After, when does self-awareness come into fruition? When are you going to acknowledge self? Like, yo, I get pissed off when you do this. Like, I know for me, the whole thing that I was speaking about with dealing with someone in non-protection, like, the whole name would piss me off. As soon as you mention this person's name, I go off. Okay, well, you got an issue. You have a problem. What is this? You know, and most importantly, I'm learning that. Like, why am I giving this person all of my power? All of my energy? You are nothing to me. And yet I've given you so much energy that you're able to sell me off in a quickness. You're here living your best life, and I'm here being triggered by you. So, you know, those type of situations kind of like check, it helps check myself to be mindful of me, my surroundings, and as well as the people that I'm surrounded by.
Thank you guys so much for sharing thus far. We definitely should transition to the next portion, or the last phase of this 3-week dialogue, which is the final presentations. Don't freak out. It's all right. It's all right. God is good, right? We got you. So you guys have shared so much quantitative data already. You know, it's like everyone passes. Yay. You know, so at this point, if you did prepare something creative, that's cool. If something comes to mind while someone's presenting, that's cool. Like, but if you don't want to present anything and you're good with that, that's cool too. Like I said, enough was already shared where you have demonstrated that you are well aware and conscious of your shadows, what that means for you, and how you're navigating it in a healthier manner. So the presentation is just icing on the cake. All right, without further ado.
So this poem is called Perfect the perfectionist. Perfect the perfectionist, says the shadow. They can bring you down, tear you apart, but they will never hear the silent cries eating you alive. She tries her hardest to never let anyone find the cracks to her most darkest inner parts of the woven self. She unconsciously holds a tight grip to the keys that unlock the tall black doors hidden in plain sight. The exit is closer than she thinks, but her projections inflate the clear path with fear and a complex idea of reality. Perfect the perfectionist, says the shadow. But how can we do that when we have been lied to from the inception of our mother's womb? We were nourished with our family's secret recipe, traumas made with righteousness and binary identities. We tried passing down a numinous legacy, a tradition that stumps each attempt for self-validation. A perfected perfectionist lives daily, afraid to heal, afraid to be forgotten, like the dark memories that caused misery. She lives comfortably, has children, goes to church on some occasions, and dresses up her stress with masks that uphold the unconscious tyranny of Trujillo's regime. My shadow steps out when there is no fair justice. She takes matters into her own hands and tears apart anyone that, like her, drowns in her silent cries for wanting more in life. Luz is her name. She is a warrior, a mother, lied from the inception of her mother's womb, nourished by her mother's pulsating insecurities, born in a patriarchal and maternalist society. She became a member of a toxic matriarch that continues to implode in and outside of itself. Lose the light for the shadow to see itself, tap into its truest form of self. Perfect the perfectionist, says the shadow. The constellations of two capis, generals grieving the past while blindly leading its future selves. Let us heal while forgiving ourselves for shutting down our own light and masking our shadow with a forced, colonized identity. Thank you. So as you guys know, my shadow, I call it Luz, which is my mom. And I've seen her present in many times that, like I've mentioned before, I've been triggered, or I've been almost like, if you think about like a deja vu, like you're taken back to an event, something that happened, where you feel like no one else may be there, like in your mind, like that's all you see, like, and so you have to step in and defend yourself. So like my mom, she's always been like this strong woman in the sense that she's never vulnerable, never has been vulnerable, never has shared a moment of just like seeing, I guess, her loved ones or her significant other, her kids as her equal, or, and then being a Capricorn, you know, we want success, but it's like success can look different. It can, you know, it can vary in different ways. It doesn't just have to be success in a career, having money and stuff like that. But I have seen my mom like very, maybe it's her love language where it's more materialistic. And maybe that's how she sees success. And God knows the many things she had to endure growing up, especially in Dominican Republic in those times where there was no room to, like, you know, cry, only maybe cry with yourself, but to kind of deal with those traumas and stuff like that. And then you end up having kids. And it's interesting because I would see how she, like many people in her generation, they immediately jump in and throw anyone under the bus, like a younger generation, for doing something that they themselves did exactly the same. And so that's why now, like more and more as I go down this journey, like I can see myself in her. And it teaches me, like, you know, we still have time to kind of change this path, change the course. Like, it doesn't have to be the same path that she took. It doesn't have to play out that way. It can look a lot more differently, not just because you have your own children, but for your own mental health sanity. And so, like, with this poem, you know, like, it kind of, it helps me, I guess, like, tap into that. And the more, I guess, I write and things like that, it helps me kind of get into that process or figure out the next moves while envisioning and seeing like what had happened, what she has gone through, and what we're probably still both fighting, that society themselves is fighting. So yeah, but thank you guys for listening.
Thank you again for sharing. What an incredible poem presentation. I think everyone's in agreement how creatively artistic you are. You're just got nothing but skills, you know. But thank you. You know, your poem was very intersectional, right? It was overlapping. There's so many different things, but you're talking about one crucial point. So we really enjoyed that, you know, the complexity of your poem, and but yet it hits the mark. The words you used really painted that picture, you know. Fire! Yeah, you weren't like, it's not like you were bashing your mom. Like you weren't even like coming across very violent or threatening, but you were just vulnerably sharing. And this right here is the kind of stuff that we get drawn to. Even in religion, this is what we were drawn to in Christianity. You know, what Yeshua, Jesus symbolized was this, you know, what we're seeking, this ability to humbly love and express, you know. And So thank you. We just wanted to comment and say that we felt that your poem embodied that, you know, and it's so divine that this is taking place outside the four walls of religion, meaning what we were craving inside is now outside, if you get my drift, you know, like, so we didn't need the four walls per se, because what we're craving seems to come out of us, you know what I mean? And we felt like it came out of you just now. So thank you. Thank you. Does anyone else have any other feedback or anything they want to add before we transition to Stephen?
It reminds me, like, her poem, her poem and imagery, like, if I was to, damn, I would love to, like, almost hear the audio of Yesenia's poem over the scene and turning red. Remember when the young girl was in that sacred space with her mother, but she encountered the younger version of her mother? Oh man, like, that's how her poem felt. Because even, like, I remember seeing that, although I'm a man, but I cried during that scene. I saw myself in this young girl.
To add to what Stephen is talking about, can we just watch this clip right quick?
The time, but it isn't true. Come on.
I'm sorry.
Shh. You don't have to apologize.
I'm your mother.
And everyone can now see visually how it plays into what Yesenia's poem was talking about. You ready to present?
Good stuff. Yeah. So ignoring myself, an ugly friend no one wants. He'll be my friend now. And then my second poem is titled A New Space. In an interstellar journey, in search of a new land, let's build a new house by neatly gathering hay to thatch the roof. For I am tired of yearning and waiting at the stone walls for warmth and love. Let us celebrate the golden house that was built with solitude, patience, steadfastness, and empathy by all of the many me. I think really to describe my two pieces, like as I really just like hone in on like what's their thesis, I think there's something that really still says I'm still in a stage of fermentation, you know, within the shadow. You know, so I guess like I wanted to be like real specific on like sharing, yeah, you know, like we all are, but like sharing where I was or like what is it, I guess, look and feel like, you know, in while in that process of really just, you know, alone with the alone, you know, for those of us that are doing, you know, the shadow work, like sometimes like what does it look like or maybe feel like, you know, sometimes in that micro moment, you know, like really quickly, you know, where you could recognize like, damn, like I don't really like this about myself, or I don't like this part of the journey, you know, but like, what does the work, you know, like look like, you know, sometimes you feel like, I guess that's what it was really, really saying about where, I guess where I'm at, like, kind of feeling like I'm in a space of still familiarizing myself with the shadow, but in that state of like kind of isolation, what Carl Jung would even refer to as like the negretto. It's like a blackening stage where like you really just sit with what makes you, I guess, you know, or perceive yourself to be, you know, in this binary term, this idea of bad, you know, versus good, right? You know, what puts you at that, you know, at that juncture in yourself. You know, but still giving, you know, thanks for the process at the same time, as difficult as it is, you know, probably like as we look back retrospectively, as opposed to the current moment, sometimes the current moment feels heavy, you know? There are moments that just like feel heavy, days that'll feel heavy. But I guess finding a sense of pride and enjoyment in that, still, you know, ironically. Yeah. That I wanted to share.
Thank you, Stephen, for what you shared. Those beautiful poems. They definitely reveal, you know, your struggling shadow or your journey. So thank you for that. All right, to wrap up, we're going to share a Theo poem that we wrote. Some of you may have seen it, heard it. Some who have not. It's all right. We're going to play it right now. And then close out. Child sits in the center of a dark room, crying, meditating on an angry thing, hyperventilating over trauma, hate being fueled by revenge, a child lost in a sea of tears, an indecent child trapped in a box of religion, in a cave interpreting shadows on a wall. A child sits in the center of a dark room, reminiscing, imprisoned by the thing that hurts most, paralyzed by abandonment, yearning for a mother's hug, a hug we never got. Death came before a hug. A child sits in the center of a dark room, alone, blinded by the morning light. Change is an unthinkable thing. A starved child becomes a black hole. Not even the light of self can escape. A shaman's shadow follows me in journey. All right. So as you probably already heard, a lot of what we have been dealing with, we wrapped into this expression, this theopoetic expression. But for me, I guess we can add that so far, the most biggest, deepest revelation was that our shadow is blinded by light. You know, this concept of an entity or a part of ourself, a symbol of ourself that does not take too kindly to light. And what does that mean, you know? And so this constant tugging back and forth, trying to figure out how much is enough light at any given time to share with my shadow, because we don't want to hurt or further hurt our shadow. We actually want to show our shadow that, you know, we love them. We love that part of ourself, right? And that may sound a little crazy, right? Because people say, how could you love the darkest side of yourself? You know? And that's what makes it so complex. This is not something you can pick up at your local Target. It's not something that can pop in a microwave and you can have it within a few minutes. It's something of a lifelong process. And we weren't really educated or cultivated to understand lifelong principles and projects and assignments and, you know, journeys. We're so accustomed and conditioned to believe that we're given tasks that need to be completed within a certain amount of time. And when we live our life like that, we come up with things like, I'm too old to be doing this, or I'm too young to be doing this. We fall into the pockets of genderism, ageism, because we're measuring our lifelong journey through time, but one perspective of time. Right? It's the time, it's the perspective of time that time is linear. And that's not true. Right? Time is circular, like everything in the universe. So this concept of things come back, everything's in a circular pattern, rotating, coming back to the same point. And it's not just start and finish, you know, and that's something that we've applied to our own approach to our shadow, Christopher, is that we don't have a time structure for you to get healed. We don't have a time structure for you to get well and see and figure this out. We've learned in our journey thus far that it's not about intelligence. Like, our shadow has to come to a point of understanding. And that may take a whole life. That may take forever. Who knows? But it only progresses when our shadow, or anybody for that matter, begins to understand. You could wrap it up, because we've tried this. You could wrap it up, put it in a certain kind of way, say certain kind of things, use certain kind of words, it doesn't matter. Because at the end of the day, people are still going to be like, I don't know what you're talking about. And so we were surrounded by people like that so much that we started to see that our shadow was like that too. And that right there is interdimensionally deep. The people we were attracting were like our shadow. Isn't that crazy? So it wasn't until we started to realize, oh shit, like we really need to start understanding our shadow better so that we can attract different people. And it worked. It is working. The more that we start to engage and challenge and care for our shadow, who came to me started to change. People around me changed. Circumstances changed, you know? So we bring this up because our shadow plays a very crucial role in that whole attraction, law of attraction. You know, like what we attract is also dependent upon our shadow too. Your light part of yourself cannot attract everything only. Like that's just silly. The math don't add up. You know what I'm saying? So it's either you attracting people by day this way and by night, you doing some other shit. You get what I'm saying? And there's people like that. So it's like this, you got to keep in mind what we attract is what we are. What we are is what we think. What we think ultimately has been tampered with, has been manipulated and conditioned. We have been captured from nature and put in boxes and cages. And then told that's our life. So with that comes all kind of crazy thoughts that only exist in those parameters. Poverty, the ghetto. I'm from Brooklyn. So, you know, we've been struggling with that shit all our life. I'm from Brooklyn. You know, that means something. You know, you don't mess with people from Brooklyn. Like Brooklyn's just wow, right? But on the flip side of that, Brooklyn has its own shadow. Stephen was talking about this in the first part of the dialogue. You know, these macro societal shadows. Brooklyn itself has its own shadow. And every Brooklynite carries a small piece of that shadow. You know what I'm saying? Like, you got your Tims on, you know, whatever, like represented. But that's not how we do it. We do it in Brooklyn like this. And everywhere we go, we do it like this. That is a form of slavery. We are trapped. We feel like we have nothing else. So we can be drawn to that stuff. We claim it. We make it part of our identity. And we say, that's what I am. You know, for years, I'm a Brooklynite for Brooklyn. Don't get it twisted. You know, like you go down to like the street, the trains, you know, like you trying to prove what? What are you trying to prove? That you tough, that you strong, that you survive. Like we all are going through that. It wasn't until we started to break through that we started to see that stuff doesn't matter. Did Brooklyn ever fucking give me anything other than heartache and trauma? Come on, man. Like you over here repping Brooklyn. Like it's equivalent to Caesar, you know, the Roman emperor. You repping Caesar. Like what did Caesar do for you? The only people that benefited from Caesar were the aristocrats. Come on, man. Like it's right there for us. You know what I'm saying? And we just don't see it. We don't connect with it. And we keep carrying and portraying all these things that are not ours. You know, so Christopher helped me lighten my load too. Because it was occasions where Christopher on the low was like, yo, bro, that's stupid. And I was like, what do you mean, stupid? You don't know what you're talking about. Lo and behold, it was stupid. You know, Christopher likes to keep it real. like really real. Doesn't have no boundaries. Doesn't care who it hurts. Just cold truth. Like enough's enough. It comes out. That's it. And we all know that, you know, some of us are capable of hurting people severely with our words. So we had to learn how not to let Christopher's words become publicly audible until we've, you know, kind of siphoned through that and said, you know, how can we, you know, add some empathy and compassion to this phrase or this approach or this truth, you know? Because that's really like, for me, the level of alchemy that we are at. You know what I mean? Like, we could sit here and just hurt everybody. Because we can observe everybody's flaws and everybody's setbacks and everybody's weaknesses, and we could just be out here hurting people. But instead, we see it, we observe it, yes, but does it need to be said? No. Maybe it needs to be, you know, converted into something else. Like, I see this person's lacking in this area. Maybe if I work with them, it'll strengthen them. That's a positive, healthy manner. Instead of just saying, yo, you're terrible at time management. What's wrong with you? Get your shit together. You know, that's some like hard, like people these days cannot handle that kind of level of communication. You know, we've been damaged and hurt so much. We need a little bit more sensitivity training, you know, a little bit more compassion, you know, like instead of coming out and telling people how they fucked up, you just, you know, I get it. I get it. I ain't even mad at you. You know what? Better than that, I forgive you. Well, you forgive me, but yeah, you know what? Thought about it. I could have done the same thing. What's stopping me from doing it? Nothing but time and opportunity, really. Because if I was in your position with the amount of resources that I thought you had and all that, I'm in your shoes, I probably would have made the same choice. Because I'm human just like you. I ain't saying going around forgiving everybody, but it does increase the amount you can forgive. And we forgive people privately. My mom passed in the poem. My mom passed before she could really tell me to my face, Aaron, I love you. My mom was that kind of hardcore person. She was an Aries. She had been to jail and all that. She was just a rough, tough woman, okay? And, you know, it was hard for her to talk about her feelings. Anyone that follows astrology understands that fire signs are terrible, terrible at sharing emotions. My mom lashed out more when she was hurting the most. Didn't figure that one out until I got to my mid-30s. But as a child, I was just thrown around the room because my mom could not bear to express or articulate her emotions. So it came out physical and rough and violent. You know what I mean? So, you know, the shadow, it's a very complicated thing. We can't say that enough. But it's also our Christopher has revealed so much to us too. Us just by us listening. You know, like we've been able to forgive our mom tremendously. You know, and a lot of people will ask me, you know, because they'll be in situations where the person that they're looking to forgive is actually living. And that's hard. That's not easier. You know what I mean? It's hard because, you know, you could maybe create an image or a story in your mind saying, you know what? I'm gonna show that person compassion. Then they turn around and do something even more stupid in your face. And it's like, you know, I was just working on forgiving you and now you just made it even harder. You know, so when people say, oh, you got it easy, Aaron, your mom, she passed, she's not around, it's easier for you to heal. No, it's not. No, it's not. I can't even have a fucking dialogue. Like, I can't get this affirmation that you understand what I'm saying and what I felt. You understand that what you did was wrong. I can't get that. So now I have to learn how to live with that I can't get that. You know, that's part of the accepting the things we cannot accept. You know, like that, a lot of people, they interpret that very literal, but it's not meant to be. Nothing's meant to be interpreted literally. You know, anyway, I feel like we went on a tangent, but we really just wanted to share these thoughts and feelings with you guys because you guys were sharing some incredible stories and feelings and vulnerabilities. So we want to reciprocate. This was amazing. Thank you so much. You all have played a crucial part into solidifying a starting point of a course that we're going to open up to the public in the next summer of 2024. But yeah, do you guys have any final thoughts, closing thoughts before we head on out?
Thank you so much for putting this together. Thank you for allowing us and creating a space for vulnerability, for having us dealing with our own stuff. Thank you for putting it back on us, for us to see in front of us, right? To take ownership to where we are. And thank you for your vulnerability.
It's a pleasure to be part of this and at the same time learning. So apart from sharing, we're also learning from each other. So this is amazing.
Yeah, no, thanks, man. Like, this is such a fluid, organic, living, breathing class, like course.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, that's what we were going for, you know, just trying different approach, you know. We love academics. We love learning and teaching and talking. So it kind of just was what we had been born with, sort of. And it just, it's slowly maturing into this. We've actually just been meditating daily about this, like, how are we going to move forward with this project? Because we work with a lot of projects, but this project seems to be something that we feel like should move forward in a bigger way, you know? So yeah, we feel motivated. So thank you. Going over the three courses, we never knew it would turn out this way. Back in February, we were just trying stuff, you know what I mean? My partner, she loves to say, just fucking around, you know, just be fucking around. And for me, as a Theo poet, that translates to being spirit led, you know. So thank you all. Seriously, we can't say thank you enough. Like, what? This is great. This is the last bit. We're going to actually transition to our dissertation writing now. Until January, we will be just writing and writing and writing. But it feels like it's been forever, honestly. It's only been like 8 months of just research, but so much information in those 8 months. Man, so much, so much. There was things we had to go back and change. So for anyone that's thinking about, you know, dissertation work, don't go in thinking that you got it all mapped out. You know, like we approach this course, just show up. Just show up. You know, and the way we built it, we wanted it to be something like that, that people felt like, you know what, just by showing up and engaging in dialogue, that was enough. Like, I didn't have to do all this reading and I didn't have to do all this writing. And so it was just a simple dialogue, you know, just come and share. And it really does change a lot of people's perspective in terms of education. And that's also something we were trying to evoke, you know. Just the dialogues we were having were so dense and layered with, oh my God, it was crazy quantitative data. You have no idea, no idea. And we were taught to just overlook that stuff. So that is why we emphasized this kind of setup, this approach. People give more without even knowing. Anyway, we love you. The world is getting crazy. Love yourself. If you don't know how to do that, work on that shit for real. At the end of the day, the capacity you have to love yourself is the capacity you have to love anybody else or any other thing. So just keep that in mind. You can't be out here talking about you love people. You don't even love yourself. So, you know what I'm saying? I love you guys. Take care of yourselves.